Hello, church. Thank you for joining me once again. Beautiful day outside. You know, we're in this series, Jesus for Everyone. And today we're going to be looking at Luke 15, Jesus Loves the Lost. You know, it's the parable of the lost sheep and the lost coin, the prodigal son. So there's a story. A woman and her grandmother were sitting on a porch discussing a member of their family. "He's just not that good," the young woman said. "He's completely untrustworthy, not to mention lazy." "Yes, he's bad," the grandmother said, as she rocked back and forth in her rocker. "But Jesus loves him." "I'm not sure of that," the young woman persisted. "Oh yes," assured the grandmother, "Jesus loves him." She rocked and thought for a few more minutes, and then added, "Of course, Jesus doesn't know him like we know him." Do you ever feel that way about yourself? People tell you God loves you, and then you think, "God must not know me very well." He really does love you, no matter who you are or what you've done, or even how long you've been doing it. That's what Luke 15 is all about. We see the context in the first two verses. Tax collectors and other notorious sinners often came to listen to Jesus teach. This made the Pharisees and the teachers of religious law complain that he was associating with such sinful people, even eating with them. In other words, Jesus got into trouble with the Pharisees because he hung around sinful people. And it was in response to that accusation that Jesus told these three stories: the story of the lost sheep, the story of the lost coin, the story of the lost son. Jesus was basically saying, "Listen, guys, I hang around with sinful people because God loves them and I want them to come home." In fact, Jesus said in Luke chapter 19, verse 10, "For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save the lost." Luke 15, Jesus shows us who God is and how he feels about lost people. In the first story, you are the sheep and God is the shepherd. The second story, you are the coin and God is the widow. In the third story, you are the son and God is the father. By looking at these three stories, we find five proofs of God's love for us. First, he will let you make your own choices. We see this portrayed in the third story Jesus told in verses 11 through 32. The story of the lost son. It takes up most of the chapter. So here's a little summary. A son comes to his father and says, "Dad, go ahead and give me my portion of the inheritance." Or in less polite terms, "Dad, I can't wait until you're dead to get my share of the inheritance. Give it to me now." Not a very respectful way of talking to his dad, but amazingly, the father in the story consents and gives his son the inheritance. The son immediately leaves home and begins to live it up, spending his money. In verse 13, Jesus says he wasted all his money in wild living. Amazingly, the father lets him. One of the things Jesus is communicating in this story is this: because God loves you, he will let you go your own way. You see, God respects your free will. He won't force himself or his will on you. He'll let you go your own way, even if it's the wrong way. God didn't make us his robots. He could have. He could have made it so that we would always do the things he wants us to do and say the things he wants us to say. Sometimes I think that would be easier. But God doesn't want our forced obedience. He wants us to love him and worship him on our own free will. So out of respect for us, really, he lets us make our own choices in life, whether to have a relationship with him or to live our lives apart from him. It's our choice. And then secondly, God shows how valuable you are to him. The way God values you is seen in all three of the stories. In the first story, the story of the lost sheep, you are like a sheep that a shepherd has lost. Verses 4 and 5. If a man has 100 sheep and one of them gets lost, what will he do? Won't he leave the 99 others in the wilderness and go to search for the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he will joyfully carry it home on his shoulders. Now you may say, "Yeah, that doesn't sound so great to me." Well, it wouldn't if you weren't a shepherd in the ancient world. A shepherd's sheep were his life. Every one of them was prized and precious. With this picture, God is saying to you, you are prized. You are precious. You are the most important thing in his life. In the story of the lost coin, you are like a coin that a poor widow has lost. Verse 8, or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Won't she light a lamp and sweep the entire house and search carefully until she finds it? Pay attention to this, that this widow only had 10 coins, each one of them worth about a day's wage. So every one of them was a treasure. Losing one was losing a lot. With this picture, God is saying to you, you are treasured. You are valuable to Him. In the story of the lost son, you are like the son who the father has lost. If you are a father, you know how important your children are. You can only imagine how painful it would be to lose one of them. Some of you know this pain from experience. With this picture, God is saying that you are as precious to Him as a child is to its father. When something is lost, its value is always intensified, isn't it? Absence makes the heart grow fonder, right? Sheep are always important to a shepherd, but when one is lost, its value is intensified. Money is always important to a person on a fixed income, but when a significant portion is lost, it is solely missed. Your children are always precious to you, but imagine how your love for them would become almost crushing weight if one of them were lost. Another story, a young woman had been seeing a psychiatrist, and the doctor had established that she was a wife and a mother of three children. And he asked, which of your three children do you love the most? She answered instantly, I love all three of my children the same. He paused. The answer was almost too quick. He decided to probe a bit, like all psychiatrists do. Come now, you love all three of your children the same? Yes, that's right, she said. I love them all the same. He said, now come off it. It's psychologically impossible for anyone to regard any three human beings exactly the same. If you're not willing to level with me, we'll have to terminate this session right now. With this, the young woman broke down, cried a bit, and said, all right, I don't love all three of my children the same. When one of my three children is sick, I love that child more. When one of my three is lost, I love that child more. When one of my children is confused or in pain, I love that child more. And when one of my children is bad, I don't mean naughty, I mean really bad, I love that child more. And then she added, except for those exceptions, I do love all three of my children about the same. In Luke 15, we are introduced to a God who is a father. As a father, he loves everyone. But the story of the lost sheep and the lost coin and the lost son make it clear that when you are away from him, when you are lost, he loves you even more. And then he searches for you. This is number three. The theme of the search is significant in all three of these stories. When the shepherd lost his sheep, he left the 99 others in the field to go in search of the one that was lost. When the widow lost her coin, she swept the house thoroughly until it turned up. And when the father lost his son, even though he didn't go searching for him, we get the impression that daily he stood on the porch looking down the road, hoping to see his son coming home. So often when we run from God, we feel it's to escape his punishment. But what we are actually doing is eluding his rescue. That's the way it is with God. If you are away from him, he is searching for you. But he's not looking for you in order to punish you. He's looking for you in order to rescue you. In fact, that's why Jesus came to earth in Luke 19, verse 10. For the Son of Man came to seek and save those who are lost. And then number four on our five evidences that God loves us, he will welcome you home. We see this primarily in the story of the lost son. Remember, here's a boy who couldn't wait for his father to die to get the inheritance. He took the money and traveled to another place, desiring to get away from the father and the rules of the home. There he wasted his money in riotous living. We pick up the story in verse 14. About the time his money ran out, a great famine swept over the land and he began to starve. He persuaded a local farmer to hire him and the man sent him into his field to feed the pigs. The young man became so hungry that even the pods he was feeding the pigs looked good to him, but no one gave him anything. When he finally came to his senses, I love that. When he finally came to his senses, don't we all need that? We need to come to our senses. He said to himself, at home, even the hired servants have food enough to spare. And here I am, dying of hunger. I will go home to my father and say, Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and I am no longer worthy of being called your son. Please take me on as a hired servant. So he returned home to his father. And while he was still a long way off, his father saw him coming. The father, filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. His son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and no longer worthy of being called your son." But his father said to the servants, "Quick, bring the finest robe in the house and put it on him. Get a ring for his finger and sandals for his feet. Kill the calf we have been fattening." So the party began. Do you believe that that is the way God will rescue you if you will come home to him? He won't scold you. He won't hold you at arm's distance. He won't hold a grudge against you. He'll just love you, forgive you, and accept you as part of his family. I think a lot of people stay away from God because they fear that he would reject them. But Jesus said in John 6, verse 37, "The one who comes to me, I will never cast out." If you'll come to God, he won't turn you away. He will love you and accept you. And then number 5, he celebrates your restoration. As evidence of God's love for us, he celebrates us, restoring into the family of God. Notice Jesus says God celebrates when a lost person comes home. Verse 7, he said, "In the same way, there is more joy in heaven over one lost sinner who repents and returns to God than over 99 others who are righteous and haven't strayed away." Verse 10, he said, "In the same way, there is joy in the presence of God's angels when even one sinner repents." And in the story of the lost son, the father says in verse 23 and 24, "We must celebrate with a feast, for this son of mine was dead and has now returned to life. He was lost, but now he is found." Does God love you? Yes. And God demonstrates his love for you, and that while you were yet a sinner, away from God, doing your own thing, going your own way in life, he sent his son Jesus to die for you. Remember, Jesus has come to seek and to save you, allowing you to make your own choices in life. God shows how valuable you are to him through searching for you and welcoming you home. He celebrates over you as you return to him. If you've been away from him, come home. And if you've been living with him, be encouraged that you matter so much to God.